I happened to be in, I was taking a trip to America in 2001, and I happened to be in New York City when 9/11 happened. And I started doing a lot of research at that time. Now, I want to mention the name of one person, which I think most everybody should try to find. His name is Mike Rupert. Okay. He did a lecture. He did a series of lectures in 2001. This was just after 9/11. Now, he's dead now, and I'm pretty sure they killed him. You know, the official story is that he did suicide. But no, that's not anyway, why? So because of these lectures he gave about 9/11, about the insider trading just before 9/11, they were selling stocks in the airlines because they knew those were the airlines that were going to crash. So Mike Rupert is the famous guy who exposed these things. Now, Mike Rupert is an ex-LA police officer. He was in the narcotics division, and he quit the LA police because the CIA was trying to get him involved in the illegal drug trafficking. So he quit the LA, and he gave this series of lectures in 2001, just after 9/11. Now here's the thing which I learned was that in 2001, as we all know, just the day after 9/11, the US troops invaded Afghanistan. Most people are aware of that. Just the very next day, the US troops invaded. They were already there waiting it, but they invaded Afghanistan. Now the question is why? Why did just the day after 9/11, the US troops invade Afghanistan? Is because they were trying to cut off the Chinese oil pipeline. Okay, this is what I learned from Mike Rupert, and I was shocked to learn these things. So then I started doing more of my own research, and I found out that China does not have a private central bank. Ever since 1949, Chairman Mao kicked out the Rothschilds and all the Freemasons and all these things. And so this was actually, and if you look at it in the bigger picture, 9/11 was actually an attack on China, because it was 6 days after 9/11 that China was forced to join the World Trade Organization. Okay. So, September 17, China joined the World Trade Organization. They had no choice, because the US troops had cut off the pipeline, the oil pipeline they were trying to build in Afghanistan. Okay, so I learned about these things. Wow, China doesn't have a private central bank, and this 9/11 was actually trying to bring China back into the central banking cartel. Okay, so this is, I moved to China in 2008. You know, and many people ask me, you know, are you a communist? They always call me these names like that. No, I'm not a communist. I'm not a member of the Chinese Communist Party or anything like that. You know, there are some, I agree with them on many issues and disagree with them on some issues. But I'm not a Chinese nationalist or anything like that. But I do work with the government, okay? I don't work for the government because I'm not a member of the Communist Party, but I work with the government on a lot of different projects because of my background in quantum mechanics.
I have a question for you, Peraza, if you don't mind. Yes. So basically what you're saying is that you're not speaking for China nor the space agency. You're speaking for yourself. The other thing that I just want you to elaborate slightly on, we get back to the topic at hand here, and you mentioned the private central bank. There's probably some viewers out there, a lot of the viewers are really in tune with what you're talking about. But for those that are not really understanding the importance of having a private central bank, pro or con, maybe you can just give a little bit of background on that.
Yes. As I mentioned, you know, I'm quite a historian. My first book is about to be published about the history of the private central banks. And this is the most important thing, because once a country has a private central bank, then all of the politicians are going to be puppets of that private central bank. So it's the most important thing you could ever study is the history of the creation of the private central banks. You know, it all began in 1609 with the creation of the Dutch Republic, which was the first private central bank. And then the Dutch took over England in 1694. They created the first private central bank of England. And then in 1800 was the first private central bank of France. And then in 1893 was the first private central bank of Italy. And then they came to America in 1913, as we all know, was the creation of the private central bank of America. And then they went to, of course, the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union was created the private central bank in 1917. And then Germany in 1918 was the creation of the Weimar Republic. And finally, in 1939 was the creation of the private central bank of Spain. So pretty much by that time, they had control over the whole world. You know, every country had a private central bank at that time, by 1939. So I made a documentary about this. It's a really nice documentary, in case you haven't watched it. But I didn't tell the full story there, because I didn't talk about China, okay? China had a private central bank from 1912. Okay. The last emperor was kicked out of China, and then they created the private central bank of China in 1912, and that lasted until 1949. Okay. So you can say what Chairman Mao did was he did an Andrew Jackson on us. You know how Andrew Jackson entered the bank in America, right? So that's where Chairman Mao figured out where all the problems were coming from. They were coming from the private central bank. Once the private central bank had destroyed the Chinese yen, you know, the currency was devaluated, and like $100 couldn't buy you a loaf of bread.
Yeah.
And Chairman Mao figured out it's all because of this private central bank. So yeah. In 1949, he ended the bank, okay? So that's why I came to China in 2008, you know, and that's just for that reason. It's because I don't want to live in a country where it's run by a private central bank. I don't want to pay taxes to them. I don't want to support them in any way.
And that too, I understand now, and I'm actually researching this myself. There's a connection between the JFK assassination and the Federal Reserve Bank.
Of course. I mean, he tried to end he issued the silver certificates of the Kennedy dollars. And this was a direct attempt to end the Fed, right? It's the same thing that Lincoln tried to do when Lincoln issued the greenbacks, you know. At the time of Lincoln, there was no private central bank, but he knew that they were trying to weasel their way back in. So when he issued the greenbacks, he was trying to end the coming back in of the private central bank. And of course, they shot him for that. And of course, Kennedy as well. He tried to issue those silver dollars. And they also, that was a big no-no. You know, you don't try to end the private central bank.
No. No. And I believe, too, that Kennedy issued a formal bill through Congress on this very matter. In essence, was taking on the Federal Reserve. And I believe it was about 5 or so months before he was assassinated. So for people who are wondering at what point did they decide he had to go, that would be a pretty good reference point, correct?
Yes. There's also another key thing was that he sent some weapons inspectors to Israel. They were searching whether Israel was only doing nuclear energy or whether they were also secretly doing nuclear weapons. And so Kennedy sent some weapons inspectors to Israel just a few months before he died. That was also a big no-no. Kennedy was concerned that Israel was not only building nuclear energy, but they were also secretly building nuclear weapons. So Kennedy sent in some weapons inspectors to Israel, and Israel was hiding all of their nuclear weapons manufacturing from those inspectors, right? So Kennedy was in support of Israel, but he was not in support of them getting nuclear weapons.
Yeah, and understand.
That was a big no-no. They wanted to have it, and they still have it today. And and this is the one thing that I agree with China on, is because China considers Israel a terrorist state. You know, China has been supporting Palestine ever since Israel was created, and Palestine has been attacked ever since 1948. China has been like, wait a minute, who gives Israel the right to do this? In the UN, you know, in the UN, of course, China is a member of the UN. Let me just mention a couple things. In 1975, it was called the UN Resolution 3379, which declared Israel an apartheid state, basically. This terrorism, what they're doing. So this was a UN resolution in 1975, and China was the main supporter of this. Let's be real here. What they're doing is apartheid. And then, of course, what happened in 1991, the UN passed a new resolution, the UN Resolution 4686. Okay, and that resolution said Israel is no more an apartheid state. And what they did was they made sure China was not there when they passed this resolution. So this is, like I said, you know, there's certain things I agree with China on and certain things I disagree with them on, you know, and I could even get in trouble. I've mentioned that in certain interviews that, you know, personally, I don't think that Tibet should belong to China, you know, and I could actually get in trouble for saying that, you know, that's a big no-no here in China, you know. I mean, of course, I'm allowed to say that, but, you know, if somebody who's working along with the government on certain projects, that would be ungentlemanly of me to say these things. So anyway, there's certain things I disagree on, like that, but there's other things I agree on, you know, like, for example, I agree to ban pornography.
Yeah. Okay.
And many other things, you know, like they don't allow gay marriage, and there's many issues I agree with them upon.
I agree. There's something that I just wanted to fall back on something here. I always had, and it's about Israel, and it always struck me as a little odd that the United Nations, and there was a lot more, you know, behind the scenes goings on at the time, and I'm just giving a bare outline here. I always thought it was strange that they would set up not only a country for the Jewish people, but then put that country right in the heart of its enemies. that always struck me as being a little bit strange. And of course, common sense tells me that was done on purpose to destabilize the region.
Well, it's much more than that, unfortunately.
Yeah.
The reason why, okay, as you know, I just mentioned the history of the private central banks. And yeah. One of the things these private central banks like to do is to fund both sides of a war, right? I mean, that's been going on ever since the what's called the Anglo-Dutch Wars. The Anglo-Dutch Wars was a series of wars fought between the Netherlands and England.
Yeah.
And it was the same bankers controlling both sides. And that's going back until the 1600s, you know?
Yeah.
So there's 400 years of the same bankers controlling both sides of every war. Now, why do they do that? It's not just for financial gains. No, it's much worse than that. The reason why they do that is because in their eyes, this is helping to fulfill messianic prophecy. Okay? The reason why these guys do that is because they believe in their hearts that war and bloodshed will help to usher in the return of the Messiah. Okay? This is all written in the book of Ezekiel. If you ever read the book of, they're just following it, that book play by play. Okay. The book of Ezekiel is talking about the return of the Messiah, and the Messiah is going to return when the world is full of bloodshed and hatred and war and sexual degradation. You know, they love these things
because
they feel that. So that's why, you know, when it comes to Palestine, you know, they could have easily wiped Palestine off the map in 1948, but they didn't want that. They want to perpetuate the torture, the terror, the bloodshed, because in their eyes, that's going to help usher in the return of the Messiah.
Exactly. Exactly. And that kind of also, we're getting into another area here, and I'm going to ask you, choose your words carefully just for the censors, because I want to put this up on YouTube. YouTube are very notorious for, you know, I'm already getting disclaimers on my videos now, so, and so is Robert. So, there's a couple of things that jump out at me here, and it's something that I did want to talk to you about is this leads into something that, number one, Kennedy himself was warning, and that was, number one, was secret societies. So we got these Freemasonic societies, you got the Illuminati, you've got a lot of these that people scoff at, but are very, very real. And as you just said, they love numbers and rituals. It's very important to them, specific dates, very important to them. That's why, because you see all these overtones and overlaying of Illuminati symbols within, let's say, the JFK assassination, because it's them signing their work and they have to adhere by a certain tradition, whatever way you want to put it. They have certain rules that they have to go by themselves. For example, predictive programming, which we see in Hollywood. So if you could just maybe talk about that a little bit, the secret societies and how important, how this all culminated in the last 3 years.
Okay. First of all, let me mention this. There is a book here in China, okay? This book is called, I don't know if you can see the English is here, it's called Currency Wars. Currency Wars.
Oh yeah.
Okay. Yes, yes. So this book is, you should, if you go to Wikipedia, okay, and you just type in Currency Wars and it's telling you about this Chinese book. Now, this Chinese book, it talks about the fact that the Federal Reserve Bank was illegally created in 1913, and these same bankers assassinated Kennedy. Okay. And so here in China, this is not considered conspiracy theory. This is considered conspiracy fact. And this book has been read by every member of the Chinese government. You can't get into the Chinese government until you've read this book. I mean, and this book is saying the Rothschilds created the private Central Bank of America. They yep. killed Kennedy. And it also mentions 9/11. And they mention the Freemasons. You know, there's an interesting thing. Is the date 9/11, September 11th, okay? That date is a Freemasonic holiday. So September 11th was an event that happened called the Battle of Stirling Bridge in 1297, where a Scottish knight by the name of William Wallace defeated the British. And this enabled the Freemasons of Scotland to survive. So they consider September the 11th like their birth date. With the attacks of 9/11, it was no coincidence that they chose this date to be the establishment of the New World Order.
Interesting, interesting.
And also the name of the two pillars of the Twin Towers was Boaz and Joachim. This is Freemasonic. There's two towers in every Freemasonic temple. And so these two towers, they represent like chaos and order. Okay. So these are the two pillars which holds up the heavens, Boaz and Joachim. These are the name of the two pillars in every Freemasonic temple. And the coming down of the pillars, the coming down of the Twin Towers, there's a Freemasonic symbolism here. It means that the old order of establishing heaven is no longer needed because the new world order has already been established. Okay, the two towers held up the heavens, but once the two towers come down, that old system of order isn't needed anymore, because the New World Order has already been established. So these are fully Freemasonic symbolisms, you know, the creation of the Twin Towers, the coming down of the towers. And you can see, you know, like a Disney, we're showing the symbolism of the towers coming down. And even Hitler, he went to
Vimy Ridge
to visit the Twin Tower Temple there in
France.
I don't know if you're familiar with that one.
Well, I haven't seen it, no. But that's interesting.
And Hitler traveled all the way to
France
just to visit this Freemasonic site.
That is fascinating.
Yes.
That's fascinating.
So coming back to my point, you know,
yeah.
This is in China, this is not considered conspiracy theory. This is considered conspiracy fact, okay? All this stuff, how the Rothschilds illegally created the Fed and all the, you know, this is what China is trying to prevent, okay? We're trying to fight for our freedom here. You know, we don't want to have a private central bank. I mean, this was what the Korean War was about. You know, China was trying to help North Korea free themselves from the private central bank of South Korea, you know? And this is also what the Vietnam War was about. China was also trying to help Vietnam escape from their private central bank, but it didn't work.
Some people are going to label you, and I want to clarify this. Some people are going to label you a communist for saying that. So, you know, be prepared for that. And I thought I would just bring that up because you have a counter argument to that accusation. And I'd just like you to give that counter argument.
Okay, many people don't know that Karl Marx was expelled from Germany, and he was expelled. He had to go live in England, where he had to live the rest of his life out in basically in hiding. You know, he couldn't even speak English, and he wasn't allowed to publish any more books. So he was banned from Germany, and the reason he was banned from Germany was because he did not agree with the communists who were planning on launching the Bolshevik Revolution. Okay, so there's a big, when you say the word communism,
yeah,
okay, We're talking about Bolshevik communism, okay? Bolshevik communism was created by the same bankers who created the private central bank of America, right? The Bolsheviks, you know, Trotsky and and they were all puppets. They were put in place, given money by the bankers in America to launch a Bolshevik revolution. And the first thing they did was they created the private central bank of the Soviet Union in 1917. So this is why Marx was actually against communism. That's why he was expelled from Germany, because he knew that they were planning on doing this. And he said, this is not the communism I want to create, you know?
Yeah.
So my definition of communism is, you know, Bolshevik communism, which is like, you know, it's just a puppet show, you know, this whole Cold War, America versus the Soviet Union. This was just a puppet show, you know, it's the same bankers controlling both sides. So yeah. I'm not, and besides that, you know, I'm not a communist. I'm not a Marxist. I'm not a, I'm just a person who studies history, and I'm a person who wants to live in a country which doesn't have a private central bank, you know, and I hope that more and more countries will free themselves from the clutches of this, you know, and it has a lot to do with, there's a hand in hand thing here with countries who are against Israel. What other country was critical of Israel? There's only been a few. Number one is China. Number two is North Korea.
Don't say Number Russia is probably.
No, Russia is completely subservient.
Subservient, really?
Yes, and that's why Putin came out and said, 9/11 was not an inside job. The moon landings weren't a hoax, you know. So this is Putin's just a puppet. Another person who did criticize Israel was Chavez, okay, in Venezuela, right?
And of course, now, he was assassinated.
Right, and he also tried to end the private central bank, okay? And he did, but he did it in a different way. Instead of just ending the bank, what he did was he issued a new currency. So there's two sets of currency in Venezuela. One is controlled by the private central bank, and one is a national currency created by Chavez, okay? And so he didn't kick out the bankers. He just provided an alternative for the citizens. Mm-hmm. And of course, the people are going to go to that. But because he didn't, if he would have just gone ahead and kicked them out, then he might still be alive today.
Yeah, I was going to say, I have a lot of suspicions about what really killed Chavez. No doubt he was obviously poisoned. Look, there's one point I want to bring up before we move on here. Just to connect the dots here, and you were talking about the symbolic aspect of all of this. And I think for people, it's important to realize that when you were talking about the insignificance of the number 11, you can actually find a photo of a well-known Satanist who was followed by a lot of British power elites and a lot of celebrities to this very day, and that's Aleister Crowley. And you can find him in a photo where he has his arms up like this, and it's symbolizing the number 11. So for people that are just saying, well, Raza does, it's just, you know, he doesn't really know what he's talking about. He knows exactly what he's talking about. And you can find that symbology everywhere. But Raza, is there anything else that you'd like to add before we wrap up?
Just help people to wake up and realize that, you know, we shouldn't just believe the media. And also the alternative media is full of disinformation, you know?
Yeah.
You mentioned the last, you wanted me to talk about the last 3 years, you know, which I assume you're talking about the COVID thing. And if you don't mind, I just want to mention the last thing here.
Sure, go ahead.
About that. Yep. Because I was actually in Wuhan when the COVID broke out, okay? I was actually in Wuhan, and I am a medical doctor, you know, so I studied virology and immunology in medical school in America. And the thing was, just before the virus broke out, there was something called the Wuhan Military Games. China had invited all the militaries of the whole world into an Olympic Games, okay? And that was being held in Wuhan just before the virus broke out. Now, what happened was China, as I mentioned, invited every country of the world, and that means China also invited Palestine. Okay, now, Israel does not recognize the existence of Palestine. Okay, Palestine's not a country. They don't have so Israel got extremely mad that China invited Palestine to the Wuhan military games. So Israel boycotted the Wuhan military games. Israel and five other countries, which they control, also boycotted the Wuhan military games. And just after the games, just a short time thereafter, I was actually in Wuhan for the games, because I'm like, wow, here's the Palestine participating in these military Olympic games, and I was actually supporting Palestine. So yeah, good go, way to go, guys. And then just a short time after that, the virus broke out, And I don't want to listen to people saying it was a hoax. I saw thousands of people dying with my own eyes. It's not a fake virus. And it was certainly not created by the Chinese government. This is just nonsense theories. This is, like I'm saying, this is the kind of information that more people need to learn, because people were being divided and conquered here,
Yeah.
The Fox News is saying that the Wuhan virus, the Fox News said it was created in the Wuhan lab. This is just total nonsense. I even know the people in the Wuhan lab. I there's one song I just posted on my channel. Okay, it says, if the people lead, the leaders will have to follow. People, take the lead, And then the song also says, as long as someone else controls your history, the truth to you will remain a mystery. Right. So this is my main thing, is I hope more people will start studying history. I just told you about the history of the bankers and the history of China, history of Israel, the China-Palestine relationships. Just study history. And this is what they don't want you to know. I just mentioned a few other important things. China joined the World Trade Organization 6 days after 9/11. Look it up, okay? I'm not just making these things up, That's the reason why 9/11 happened, is because China kicked out their private central bank in 1949. And ever since the World Trade Organization was formed, China's like, no, we don't want to be part of that. We're going to get our own oil, right? So they were trying to build an oil pipeline through Afghanistan. And as soon as the U.S. troops came and cut it off, China was forced to join the World Trade Organization. Okay, they still don't have a private central bank. And that's the goal of these bankers now. Their goal is to bring private central banking back to China. And this is what the whole World War III is about. They're trying to get China in bed with Russia and Iran, because those two are already puppets, but China's not a puppet. So the real agenda is to get the private central bank back into China. And, it's not going to be easy. China is an inferior military. So, there's not much, if the bankers go ahead with their World War III, there's not much China's going to be able to do about that.
No.
But anyway, that's my point. Study your history. Okay. Study your history. The Rothschilds created the private central bank. They killed the Kennedy. They did 9/11. It's all here in this book. I mean, more people need to learn these things, because the more we can help people become educated about these subjects, then the less people will participate in all these banker wars.
I would also like to add that it's a very good point you raised, Raza, and I also like to add to all the people out there, be very careful. I think your message is very, very clear, and I'm going to end on this message because it's such a positive note for all the people listening right now. Take the lead. Take the lead. Do your own research. Do your own thinking.
When the people lead, the leaders they will have to follow. And all their lies and their alibis they will have to swallow. Yes, when the people lead, people take the lead. Children, you've got to take your lead, or you shall be led. So as long as someone else controls your history, the truth, it shall remain just a mystery. Well, you can lead a horse to the water, you cannot make him drink. You can put a man through school, but you cannot make him think. When the people got to